Welcome to Environmental Fridays. It is personal, season 3. This season we'll be featuring 12 episodes with 12 guest speakers from Barbados, Delaware, Grenada, Illinois, Kansas, Michigan, St. Lucia, Trinidad, Washington, and Virginia. Now here's our host, Dr. Desmond Hartwell Murray. And today's co-host, Alex Little. And our guest speaker, Marcy Hamilton.
Okay, good morning, everyone. Welcome again to Environmental Fridays. Let me get my slideshow started here. So this is season 3 of Environmental Fridays. It is personal, and we want to welcome all of you. The question, one of the questions before us today is, can environmental restoration be achieved? And to just set the mood, I like mood, we will play this song. Okay, so I know the context for that song is usually for civil rights, but I think it also does apply to environment. It could also apply to environmental, that the idea of a change is going to come. And so I think this gives us hope, because we don't need to throw up our hands frustrated by pollution. It is reversible, and we'll see that here in the Ox Creek story today. And this rain garden in progress that you're seeing now is evidence and symbol that we have agency. We can reverse the harmful effects of our past environmental indiscretions. With vision, imagination, and perspiration, a change is gonna come. So, I invite each one of you to also check out our website, Environmental Fridays. It's www.theenvironmentalfridays.com. And what I'd like to also encourage is for us to share your thoughts with us, for you to share your thoughts with us, suggestions, ideas, 100 ways or less, with your name, affiliation, send this to murrayd@andrews.edu. And some of these will be published online at our testimonials page. So we're gonna need some people to turn down their mute their sound. Okay. And coming up next week, we are gonna have a speaker from the United States Forest Service talking about managing forest wildfires. Today, I am honored, privileged to have as our speaker, as our co-host that will introduce our speaker, Mr. Alex Little. So again, please, if you haven't muted your sound, please mute your sound. Okay, we need people to mute your sound. Thank you. All right, so our co-host for today is Alex Little. He is currently the Community and Economic Development Director and Assistant City Manager for the City of Benton Harbor. He has a degree in Industrial Relations from Southern Illinois University and a Bachelor's in Organizational Management from Bethel University. He has 50 years of experience in public administration. For example, he was the assistant city administrator for Ann Arbor, for Green Bay, Wisconsin, for Gary, Indiana, for Harvey, Illinois. And he retired, quote unquote, because he's working now, retired from Broward County in Florida. In Benton Harbor, he has held the positions of city manager and economic development director, both of these twice. And he began the process of the city, for the city, working towards redevelopment of Ox Creek Corridor, and is working on that project with our speaker today, Marcy Hamilton. So, Mr. Little, the time is yours now to introduce our speaker for today.
Good morning, everyone. It's my distinct pleasure this morning to introduce Marcy Hamilton. Marcy is the Deputy Executive Director, Senior Planner at Southwest Michigan Planning Commission. She has worked in Southwest Michigan for over 20 years on water quality, community and economic development, and parks and trails. Marcy serves on and advises many nonprofit organizations, Two Rivers Coalition, St. Joseph River Watershed Council, Friends of Berrien County Trails, Preserve the Dunes, Partnership for MEANDRS, which stands for Meeting the Ecological and Agricultural Needs of the Dowagiac River System, and Southwest Michigan Sustainable Business Forum. Marcy holds a bachelor's degree in biology and environmental studies from Ohio Northern University and a master's in environmental science degree from Miami University, Ohio. Marcy.
Thank you, Alex, and thank you, Dr. Murray, for inviting me today to talk about Ox Creek. I'm really excited to share my story about Ox Creek. We've been doing a lot of work over the years to try to bring this little creek back to life for the community. So I'm going to share my screen real quick while I pull that up. Okay, can everybody see that?
Good? Yes, we are seeing it.
Okay. Great. All right. So obviously, Alex told you a little bit about me, but just kind of, I have a very unique job. Most people don't know what the Southwest Michigan Planning Commission is. We cover three counties. We're one of 14 regional planning agencies in Michigan. We were created by the state government back in the early 70s to deal with regional issues that affect a lot of issues that cross jurisdictional boundaries. Of course, rivers are one of those, right? They cross jurisdictional boundaries. So it's a regional issue. But we also do economic development, transportation planning, community planning, master planning, recreation planning. I do a lot of grant writing for different projects throughout Southwest Michigan. So basically, anything that I can get involved with to make Southwest Michigan a better place to live, work, and play, I'm interested in it and trying to work towards that goal to make this a great place. It already is a great place. Make sure it stays a great place and make it even better. So a big piece of my background and work centers around water quality and work on all the rivers and creeks in Southwest Michigan. And Ox Creek kind of really stood out. It's really a special creek that goes right through the middle of Benton Harbor and needs some attention and love. So that's why I've been working on it, and I get to meet wonderful people like Alex and other folks who are also passionate about it. So that's what makes my job so wonderful, is working with wonderful people that care about these types of things and want to see it better. So with that, I want to talk a little bit about Ox Creek and what's happening with just kind of an overview of Ox Creek. If you don't know much about it, we're going to go through a little tour with pictures. I'm going to talk about impacts that are happening on Ox Creek to the water quality and the habitat, and why that's what's causing those impacts, and some potential solutions. And then I'm going to talk about some of our progress on improving the creek and the future efforts that are planned. So if you don't know, here we are in Southwest Michigan in Berrien County. Ox Creek drains about 13 square miles here. It actually is the last water body to enter the Pawpaw River, which then goes into the St. Joe and out to Lake Michigan. So the St. Joseph River watershed is huge. It covers 15 counties in Michigan and Indiana. So we're obviously a little small part of the St. Joe River watershed. And I just want to make sure that everybody knows what a watershed is. When I say watershed, it's basically all the land that drains to a common body of water. So all this area outlined in yellow is draining through all the creeks and rivers to the St. Joe River and coming out to Lake Michigan. You know, Ox Creek, this red area, all that land is draining to Ox Creek and coming into the Pawpaw and out to Lake Michigan through the St. Joe. This is just blowing up. This is a close-up of the Ox Creek watershed. It starts out in Bainbridge Township. It's down into Sotus Township. A majority of it is in Benton Charter Township. And then it flows through right through the middle of Benton Harbor, the city of Benton Harbor, where it enters the Pawpaw River and then makes its way out to Lake Michigan. So like I said, it drains about 13 square miles. And what we know about Ox Creek, it is not meeting our state water quality standards. I personally, for all of our creeks in our three county area that I cover, Ox Creek is the most impacted creek. And we'll go through why that is and why we need to spend some time on Ox Creek. Kind of interesting, when we talk about water quality, you have to look out into this area that's draining to the creeks and the rivers. And when you look at Ox Creek, it's kind of, I put this red line here. It almost follows Interstate 94, which 94 is, you know, the major interstate that runs from Chicago to Detroit. So that kind of bisects this watershed. And so to the east of I-94, it's all agricultural mostly and residential. And then to the west of I-94, it's really getting more urbanized and into the city where it would have a lot more high intensity development. So that's kind of showing that land use and some pictures from the watershed in those different areas. So this is my little tour of Ox Creek. So this is Ox Creek right when it enters the Pawpaw River here in downtown Benton Harbor. There's just some pictures of it. Obviously, it's very been very manipulated in this area. It's very straight. They've straightened it through here. It runs through the Harbor Shores Golf Course. Then it runs through the Arts District. And as you can see, it's lined with sheet pile and concrete, so not very habitat friendly for the fish. So a lot of manipulation has happened to the creek down here. As we move upstream, we get where it goes right through the middle of Benton Harbor and kind of separates these neighborhoods. But also look at this wonderful forested corridor here through the middle of the city. It's down in this ravine and it's gorgeous down there. There's a lot of beaver activity down there right in the middle of Benton Harbor. My friend and I kayaked up the creek from Highland at Hall Park up almost to Britain Avenue. Saw lots of beaver dams. I even fell into Ox Creek trying to get over one. That was a little concerning, but I'm still here to talk about it. So that's good. But it's really beautiful through this corridor, through the city. It's really quite amazing. There is some dumping that has happened and some trash that needs to be cleaned up. But you can tell the beauty that's there and why people tell stories when you talk to them about Ox Creek and their memories of Ox Creek and fishing in it and playing in it as a kid, because it really is beautiful. Then we move on upstream to around I-94, Interstate 94 and Pipestone and Napier, where all of our commercial area is. This is where all of our big box stores are, you know, Lowe's and Home Depot and Meijer and the big Orchards Mall. So a lot of impervious surface here for the creek that flows through here, and not as pretty as it is through the city. And I'll talk a little bit about this area and how it impacts the creek. But as we move upstream from there, then we're crossing over I-94. This is where the new 31 is being built to be connected to I-94. So we're out in the farmland, and this the creek kind of looks small and through the, it goes through all the farm fields and a bunch of different tributaries that feed into Ox Creek are out here. So that's kind of the tour from the mouth of the creek where it enters the Pawpaw to its headwaters out in the township where it's agriculture. I want to talk a little bit about the impacts and why we're seeing water quality issues in Ox Creek. One of the biggest things is we've lost a lot of wetlands in Ox Creek. The red areas are areas that have what used to be wetlands before humans came and drained them from agriculture, filled them in to build housing and industry and things like that. So we've lost about 72% of the wetlands in the watershed. We have about 400 acres that are remaining. We've lost over 1,000 acres that were either drained or filled in those red areas. And what does this mean? It means that our watershed or water bodies, those wetlands are really important for handling floodwaters after rain events. So we've lost about 78% of the capacity to mitigate flooding by losing these wetlands. We also know that these wetlands are, they're kind of like our kidneys. They filter the water as it moves through the landscape. And that's a very important function for water quality, filtering out all the pollutants and the sediment. And the sediment falls out into these wetlands, but because we've lost them, we've lost about 85% of the capacity to retain sediment. And so sediment is actually one of the biggest pollutants in our watershed. Dirt coming off the land and moving into the creek and clogging up the creek and destroying the habitat. So that's a big factor that we're dealing with. Something else that I'm not very versed in, but this is a big issue for Ox Creek, is we have some major contaminated properties along the creek. Where these stars are, there's one up here towards the mouth called Modern Plastics. We don't have a lot of data on it, but we're pretty sure it's contaminated property right along the creek. This one here, Michigan Gas Utilities, which I'll talk about some restoration efforts and their cleanup efforts they've done here. They've done a really nice job of cleaning the site up and restoring the creek through this stretch. And then Harbor Plating is a huge one. Initial price tags, I think, Alex, what? They're like saying $10 million to clean up that site. Highly contaminated from the plating operation that was operating there years ago. So obviously causing major problems with heavy metals and different names of chemicals I can't even pronounce that are in on these properties and coming into the creek. And so that's obviously affecting the habitat and water quality of the creek. And then we move out into the agricultural area that I talked about. And there's, you know, the agricultural practices out there could be improved to keep the sediment on the ag fields and instead of getting into the creeks, things like cover crops or using no-till, restoring some of those wetlands, keeping a buffer along the river so that when the water runs off, it's filtered before it gets into the creeks and moves into the down the system. So there's things out in the agricultural area that we could be doing better. Then we get to this retail area out by I-94 and Pipestone. We have over 4,000 acres of impervious surface, roads, parking lots, rooftops. All this dark red area is area that's, when the water hits, it's draining to the creek really quickly and damaging the creek. So we need better practices here. This is where the rain garden comes in that I'm going to talk about. Rain gardens are a way to soak that water in and slow it down and help it filter out before it gets into our creek. Talk a little bit about this. So this is an interesting map. This is land cover change from 1975 to 2016. So you can see this whole area was built out. And when it was built, we didn't really understand or maybe care maybe about how we developed the land and how it impacted our water resources. And so this isn't just in Ox Creek. This isn't any urbanized area that was built up at these times. Our policies, the engineers, I don't know if we have any engineers here today, but they're the way they dealt with water when they were going to build something was get it off the property as quickly as possible and send it to the nearest creek wetland area. And that's the way we dealt with our stormwater. Now we're paying the price from that, and we're seeing how that really affects our water quality and our habitat. So this is kind of a graph that shows once you reach about 10% of impervious surface in a watershed, you start impacting the stream health of the, where the water's going. Oh, sorry about that, I didn't move. So like this is, you know, if you're under 10% roads, rooftops, parking lots, you know, more green area than built up area, your creek is going to be healthy and look really pretty and nice like this one. Once you move into the over 30% impervious surface, and this area is about 40% impervious surface. So we've hit this, you know, red area where the water is being sent to the creek after a big rain event, and it causes really flashy flows, it causes erosion, and you end up with creeks that look more like this, not very pretty and very degraded habitat where the fish, the macroinvertebrates can't live and the fish can't live because it's being blown out by this high flashy flows after rain events. So that's what's happening in our creek. And like I said, those macroinvertebrates and other aquatic life can't survive those flashy flows and all that sediment and silt coming down and filling in parts of the creek and covering up the habitat. So flashy flows and suspended solids and that sediment is really what's degrading the habitat of the creek and the water quality in Ox Creek. So back to this retail area. So there's about 315 acres total in this red outline. And about 95 acres, the light blue shaded areas, are the stormwater is being somewhat treated. In the other 220 acres, 70% of this property, it's going directly into a pipe and going straight out to Ox Creek or a tributary to Ox Creek, and with no treatment, no slowing down. So that's where these practices are coming in, where we're trying to get folks to say, we need to do a better job in how we handle our stormwater in these areas. I like to say we have a parking problem. Most people at times when you say we have a parking problem, you think about a really busy downtown and you can't find a parking spot. That's a parking. Well, in this case, the parking problem is too much parking lots that aren't being used. This is, we actually went out and did drone photos on the day after Thanksgiving, right? One of the biggest shopping days of the year. And these parking lots were not full, even on the busiest days of the year. So we have a parking problem. We have too much parking. And as we talked about, all this impervious surface is not good for the creek. The good news is that this is the Meyer parking lot, which we just took out this whole parking lot and put a rain garden in it. I'll talk about that later. So we're seeing some good changes. But this is the philosophy is, you know, when we develop areas or redevelop them, we want to put in systems like green roofs, pervious pavement, rain gardens and areas for the water to filter and before it just goes straight into a pipe and out to the creek. We want to slow it down, spread it out, and soak it in so that it's not hitting the creek at that fast pace like it does now. So progress being made, that's what we're all about. We're trying. I love the song that you picked, Ms. Dr. Murray, about change. Actually it was interesting. I had a meeting with a group of students who canoed the St. Joe River all the way from Goshen, Indiana to here and came out to Lake Michigan. Mm. And I met them when they arrived at Lake Michigan. They camped along the way. And it took them a whole week to do that trip. And they asked me what the St. Joe River meant to me. And I said, change. Okay. And because rivers change courses over time, everything around them is changing, and that impacts how the river changes. And change is what we need to do as community members and residents of these watersheds. We need to change our behaviors and do things differently to ensure that these waters are improved and maintained. So I love that pick. Thank you.
You're welcome.
So the progress being made, and actually this goes back to Andrews University. We did an effort back in around 2016, and we had a class from Andrews University, they were landscape architects, come in and work with Whiteman and Associates, a local engineering firm here in Benton Harbor. And we held what we called a parking day out at out near the mire there and got people's input of what would they like to see, you know, how can we green this area up, make it more friendlier to the creek, but also make it just more attractive. If you've been to the Orchards Mall area, it's not the prettiest place to be because of all the concrete and asphalt and parking lot. So how can we make it greener, nicer? And so we had design charrettes where the students came in from Andrews University and held meetings. And this is actually up in Whiteman's office. And the other one is at in the Orchards Mall in one of the abandoned stores there. Mm. And we held meetings and invited the community to come and tell us what they would envision for this area. And there's a website, sustainoxcreek.org, that shows a lot of this work of what kind of what it looks like now and what it could look like in the future. And not only does it look better and hopefully more attractive for people shopping or doing whatever, you know, working and living, more places for people to live, but also more greener so that we're more friendly to Ox Creek. So we did a lot of work in the community to develop some vision of what that Orchards Mall area could look like. And that's kind of what started this whole rain garden thing. Other progress is there's been annual cleanups, volunteer cleanups on Ox Creek. Community groups have been organizing them and getting together. The city has been very supportive in helping with disposing of the trash. And Adam Marsh, who's on the phone today, has let us use their recycling bins to put all our recycling that we collect in there. So that's been just a community effort that's grown, and there's gonna be another one next spring that the Berrien Conservation Districts, they were supposed to have it this year, it got rained out, bad weather, so it's gonna happen in the spring now. So these are annual events that get the community out, engaged in the creek, and helping to make a difference and get engaged with the creek. So rain gardens, yes. So the first rain garden actually went in at Whiteman, which is that local engineering firm. Their property is just off of Pipestone on the east side of I-94. And they have a huge parking lot. And so we took out this whole parking lot area and made a big depression and put in better soil and then planted it with native plants, which do a really good job of soaking up that water and filtering out those pollutants. And we actually had a community day where people came out and helped to plant all the plants, and it's working great. So there's actually a storm drain here that the water used to just flow off these rooftops and parking lots straight into the storm drain and straight out to the creek that flows into Ox Creek. So now what we've done is all that water coming off this area comes through these rocks and through all these plants, and then it slows it down, soaks it in, filters out, and then any overflow goes into this structure now and out to the creek. So very little water gets there, and it's protecting the creek. So that one was done back in 2017. This is the one that we just completed at Meyer. I helped the Berrien County Drain Commission get a grant to do this. And this is Meyer's last outlot, which they donated to the Berrien County Drain Commissioner. So it's about almost a $500,000 value that they donated for this project. And we took this entire parking lot out, it's almost a half acre, and replaced it with a big rain garden. Same concept, we dug it out, put in compost soil, put in the native plants, trees and shrubs, and it's capturing that water coming off of their building and their parking lot. We also put three smaller ones within the parking lot, and they all have little signs that say, this is a rain garden and I'm helping improve Ox Creek. And again, the water from the parking lot comes in here, it has time to settle out and soak in before it gets into the drain. And these three rain gardens end up draining to the big one. So it's kind of, we call it a treatment train. You know, the water flows into these, then it goes through a perforated pipe underneath the parking lot into this new structure here, where it comes in and is filtered out one more time before it enters the creek. So if you are in the area, I know some of you are not in the area, but if you are in the area, I highly recommend going and checking it out. It's pretty impressive and pretty cool project. And Meyer has been a great partner to work with on it. So the other in progress thing I want to mention, so that's, I said Michigan Gas Utilities was a contaminated site down in downtown Benton Harbor between Highland and Maine. Over the years, they've removed a lot of their buildings and dug out a lot of the contaminated sediment. They have monitoring wells where they're monitoring the groundwater to see where the contamination is moving. And then this last year, they actually restored this section of creek from Highland to Maine. And this was all overgrown with invasive species, mostly Japanese knotweed. which is, you know, a very harmful plant that's taking over, you know, our landscape. So they removed all of that, and they kind of put a little bit more curve into the river. They actually dewatered the entire river or creek between Highland and Maine, and they put down a liner so that any of that groundwater contamination can't get up into the creek. They didn't think it would, but as a kind of, you know, just a extra caution, they did that. And then they put in habitat with stones and large woody debris, logs and stuff to build habitat for fish. And I was amazed when I went down there when they were dewatering it. They had a biologist, a fisheries biologist, catching all the fish and saving them and putting them in the other side of the river. And the amount of fish that they were catching and the kinds of fish, I was truly amazed that those fish are still in there. And hopefully we can bring back some of this habitat, that we can bring back even a healthier fish population. So this is a great start. And we hope to move this type of restoration effort upstream through Hull Park and on up. And that's what the city has been working on. And so just switch over to progress. And the city is really, made this a priority. They passed a resolution last fall saying the revitalization of Ox Creek is a top priority for the city of Benton Harbor. They started their master planning process and have made Ox Creek an important element of that whole process and giving it a lot of attention and asking the community, what do they want to see for Ox Creek? And so they also hired U of M, a landscape architect, to look at a Hull Park, which is the main big park there at Highland along Ox Creek. I think it's the city's oldest park, Alex, is that right?
It is, yes.
Yeah, and it's just, it's a wonderful gem, and talk about people's memories of get-togethers and family gatherings at this park. And it's right along the creek, and it can be beautiful along with the creek. So the landscape architect from U of M is working on developing a vision of what that park could look like, and also a trail along Ox Creek. But it's really been interesting. They've done a lot of community input sessions, and what people want is they want to be able to enjoy the creek and the native flora and fauna. And they want to be able to be in nature and bird watch and have, you know, a nice view of the creek. This is actually a picture of, there's an old railroad bed that goes along the creek all the way from downtown out to that retail area at 994 and Pipestone. And Alex, when he was here years ago, what, in the
90s?
80s. In the 80s, he had enough foresight and vision to have the city purchase that railroad corridor. So the city owns that whole corridor along the creek, and we're looking at putting a trail in there. And this is an old bridge across the creek as part of that system that hopefully we can restore and make this a walking and biking trail along the creek. So really, really amazing stuff. But this, you can just see how beautiful it is through the city. It's gorgeous down in this ravine. It's really beautiful and has a lot of potential. This is just a map. Sorry, I'm recovering from COVID. So I still have a little lingering cough there. Sorry, I'll just take a drink. So this is just a map that shows what we call potential conservation areas. So this is Hull Park here, Highland Avenue, all the way out to I-94. That whole, and you can see these darker colors around here mean there's really good habitat and potential for really high quality natural areas in this ravine that goes through the city. And like we saw from those pictures, really already beautiful. But what the city just has done is they just submitted, we submitted on behalf of the city, a grant to NOAA for doing a whole habitat restoration project of the creek and riparian corridor along through the city here from Highland to Napier. So we're hoping to get that funding and bring in schools and the Boys and Girls Club and folks to get engaged with the planning for the restoration of the creek. So fingers crossed, we'll get that. And this shows where that Michigan Gas Utilities restoration site is. So like you said, we'd like to move that on up through Hall Park and restore the creek. So overall, the city has compiled a nice big team. I'll share that with you in a minute of who's all on that, but we've been working on kind of these six major elements. And this is where my work, this is where I love it. This is what I kind of call a wicked problem, right? There are so many impacts and things going on impacting this creek. And we had to attack it from a lot of different angles, and we need participation from the farmers to the retail landowners to the homeowners to everybody in between, and the governments, local, county, regional, state, and federal to make this happen. But we're looking to continue to improve the water quality by putting in more of those rain garden type structures out in that retail area. It's also something that people could do in their own yards at home, rain gardens on a small scale. You know, what we've done at Meyer and Whiteman is obviously really big scale. These can be done on individual properties and on a small scale and can really be helpful to the overall creek. We're going to continue, like I said, to restore the creek and the riparian habitat, hopefully bring back that habitat so the critters can live in the creek and bring back the fishing and the opportunity for people to recreate in the creek and enjoy it. I mentioned there's been dumping along the creek. We've got a plan to remove that and work with the community to help build stewardship so that we don't see that dumping anymore in the future. Again, Hall Park, that beautiful big park along Ox Street, to restore that, make it a community gem again where people want to be. Build that trail and boardwalk along the Ox Street that would connect the Arts District in downtown with that I-94 retail area. So not only would it be beautiful for recreation, but that's a huge transportation corridor to get people back and forth between those two nodes. And then of course, working on those legacy industrial polluted areas and seeing if we can get those cleaned up, because once they can get cleaned up, then they can support redevelopment of housing and mixed use and commercial and make that a vibrant area where people can live along the creek and enjoy it in the future. So I got this little graphic here, environmental, economic, and social. So, I mean, this is all a big picture as part of this restoration and kind of hits all of those areas for the city and the community. Partnerships are key. This is one of our tours that Alex and the community gave to a bunch of folks from Eagle, the state, and from to the federal government and U of M. Come out and look at Ox Creek. And they come out and they're like, wow, this is really amazing. We have, and they're all stepping up to help us. So that's exciting. But this is a list of a lot of the groups and agencies from local to state to regional to federal that are stepping in and helping. In the next month, Department of Environment, Great Lakes and Energy are going to be out taking sediment samples in Ox Creek from Napier to Hall Park to see if the sediments are contaminated in the creek. We need to know that if we're going to be doing restoration of the creek. We need to know if those sediments are contaminated or not. So we're getting information we need to move this process along. And EPA has been down here and looked at the creek and are coming back again, and looks like they're going to be offering, you know, hopefully offering resources to the city to get some of these places cleaned up along the creek. So we're really excited about that. Alex, aren't we? Like, people are stepping up to help. We're like, this is amazing.
Matter of fact, Marcy, if I could, I'd like to add one. The Detroit Riverfront Conservancy is coming to join us, and they've agreed that they're willing to be recognized as an advisor to us on this project. Great. They've done a lot of what we're trying to do.
Okay. Yeah, at a much bigger, you know, level in Detroit. It's, you know, kind of same issues, same problems here in Benton Harbor. So having the experience of these other communities who are doing similar things is wonderful. So that's a great addition to the team. And this team is ever growing. And it's open to grow more, because this is a big, complex problem with a lot of issues, a lot of things going on, and we need the expertise to come in to help us attack this from all the different angles. I just put this up here. River cuts through rock, not because of its power, but because of its persistence. Mm-hmm. And I think that's a very fitting, quote for this effort. It's going to take persistence. It took us, 100 years to get here, and all the impacts that's happened with the pollution and the way we've handled our stormwater. It's going to be a long-term solution to this. And so it's all about perseverance and persistence, and getting people, these partnerships are key to get them in line and moving towards these goals. And that's my story about X Creek and what we're trying to do and try to accomplish to really bring this creek back to life for the community. So thank you for listening.
Okay, thank you so very much. Thank you. So Alex, do you want to make a comment, thank Marcy, and start the question period?
I certainly would like to. We at City of Benton Harbor are very grateful to Marcy for all that she's doing to assist us with this. We consider this Ox Creek to be one of the most critical keys to redevelopment of the city overall. As you could see from the map, it divides the city. There are basically about four places you can go from one side of the city to the other. After you pass Highland, there's a crossing at Breton Avenue, there's a crossing at Empire Avenue, and there's, of course, the M139. But other than that, the city is basically separated by this corridor. And that doesn't have to be all bad if it's put back together right, because from the stories that we've heard, like when we met with the senior citizens at their picnic, there used to be like a walkway that came down from one bluff on the west side around Vineyard Street that went down the hill, crossed up over the creek, and came up on the other side around High Street. That's where a lot of the school children years ago used to walk down and go through there over the creek and get to school on the other side. We intend, as a part of the restoration process, to put a couple of those back in. That gave people, and especially young people, an active part in living with Ox Creek back in that period. And some of those seniors talked about how enjoyable it was when they did that. So in addition, as Marcy said, once the water is cleaned up, where it becomes available for fishing, canoeing, kayaking, nice elevated lighted bike trail, walk path along the side of the creek from Benton Township all the way to downtown Benton Harbor. And the opportunities, once that's all cleaned up and opened up for redevelopment, possibly housing, possibly commercial and retail. Not only will it help the city in terms of rebuilding its tax base, but we think it'll add a beautiful component to it that people from all over will be able to come and enjoy. We get over 100,000 people during the summer coming up from Chicago, going up Lake Michigan up to South Haven, Ludington, all up and down through there. And if we've got something beautiful like this here, they'll take advantage of it and utilize it. So again, we certainly thank Marcy and Southwest Michigan Planning Commission for their help on this. And we thank you, Dr. Murray and Andrews, for highlighting this.
Okay, thank you so much. So we have, I see one question in the chat. Leslie, you could unmute. Anyone, could unmute. Leslie, if you want to unmute and ask your question.
Sure. My audio doesn't work very well sometimes, so apologies in advance. I think I need a new laptop.
Okay.
I am interested, there's a wetland area, I think it's referred to as Miller Pond, that's just between like the high school and the St. Joseph River. And I know it doesn't fall into this Ox Creek area, But our home is really close to it, and walking down by that area, it's kind of hidden. But I just wondered if you could speak to it. It seems like it's kind of a lost, forgotten area. Thank you.
I'll comment briefly and then ask Marcy to expand, if you will. But we have been looking at Miller's Pond for quite some time as a potential solution or aid to addressing another problem that we have. In addition to Ox Creek, even greater waterway impacting the city and can be in a much more positive fashion is the St. Joseph River that runs right past the area where Miller's Pond sits back off of 11th Street behind the old bank that was there. When the lake levels rise, and of course the river levels rise with it, our water table in that lower region, all up and down Riverview Drive and all below the hill where the high school is and so forth, tends to rise up too. This presents an impediment to the kind of development we'd like to see and have along that riverfront. We think possibly Miller's Pond, if deepened and used to sort of help drain water out of that lowland area, could help to solve that. Of course, another part of it is that if that happens, there has to be some pumping to keep the water moving out of Miller's Pond and to where it drains. But Marcy, go ahead.
Yeah, I was just going to say, I don't think there's been any testing that I know of in terms of the quality of that wetland area or the water in it, but it would depend on past land uses in that area if there is anything impacting it. What I see there now, I don't see any immediate threats to it. I mean, there's some parking lots and but there's still a lot of green space around that area, so I wouldn't expect anything to be really bad with the wetland area unless there was something, you know, done years ago that impacted it. But most likely it's probably a pretty healthy wetland area surrounded, you know, in an urban area. So it is taking a lot of water and doing an important function for that area in terms of handling the water that comes there with the high, especially with the high water levels. So it's a very important asset to the city.
So I see Samsung, I don't know who you are, but could you identify yourself and ask a question? If not, I'll read the question. Will you expand on the economic development and housing phase of this project?
Certainly. We are studying and starting a process for redevelopment and development of housing throughout the city of Benton Harbor. Benton Harbor at present is the classic underserved community in the sense that we have a population now of a little over 9,000, where as late as when I came here in 84, the city had 15,000 plus residents and probably about 5,000 housing units. Now we're down about 3,007. We look at the potential for part of the land area along Ox Creek to be a catalyst for some really nice housing to go in that area along Ox Creek. But we think once that's all beautified, that it's going to impact also the bluffs that sit up over Ox Creek. I think the land on both sides, on those bluffs, are going to become much more valuable, and we expect to see probably a lot of redevelopment and possibly new housing along there. Right at present, we have one housing project that's going to add 100 housing units called Project T on the old Mercy Hospital site, which is about a quarter of a block from where Ox Creek passes right through by it there at Empire Avenue. And we think those two are going to complement and impact positively each other. In addition, we have Whirlpool working on its 80-unit housing development at 170 Riverview Drive. And expect that's going to be completed in the coming year and become occupied. They just renamed it after one of our former mayors, our only lady, a female mayor, Ms. Emma Hull. In addition, we have a project going with MHT Housing to develop a 55-unit permanent supportive housing unit that will also have the first grocery store in town near the downtown area. As a matter of fact, just a couple of blocks from City Hall where I am. So, and I'm working with one developer right now that's looking to come in and put 55 units. So we have space, we have infrastructure, we have a lot of the things that successful housing needs. And this county has a shortage of both workforce and affordable housing. With all of the vacant lots sitting on improved streets, curbs, gutters, sidewalks, water, sewer, electricity, gas, everything is there except the house. So we are looking to work with developers to come in and begin rebuilding this area, rebuilding the city's population, rebuilding the tax base. And what's happening with Ox Creek, we think, is going to be a catalyst to help feed all of this kind of development.
Okay. So my question, I have several, but given the time and all of that, I want to focus my question on the community, meaning what specific things can the community get involved in? To be even more specific, during the summertime, when our students, are not in school, are there specific projects during that time? There's an echo. That they could get involved in, and maybe even get employed and get employment, because this is a great project. Is going to last for generations, it sounds like to me. And so we have to start, I think, making sure that the community has ownership, they get good jobs from it, make sure our youth are involved in it. That's the thing that I want to find out, if there are concrete plans for in this project.
Yeah, actually the application we just submitted like a week ago to NOAA is all about capacity building and public engagement in the restoration planning process. There's money in there to help the city hire a position to kind of manage this project and increase the community engagement piece of it. Right now, up till now, we just haven't had, we've done some little things. Like I said, we brought in the MEANDRS students to do the charrette stuff, envisioning stuff. We do try to do the community cleanups. We don't really have the capacity right now to do much more than that. So this NOAA funding would help us bring some of that funding in to help us build that capacity where we could start working with the school, start working with the Boys and Girls Club, engage our local universities more in helping us plan and execute the restoration strategy that we develop. So that's exactly where we're going. And we have detailed plans I'm more than willing to share with you on the application we just submitted. Mm-hmm. So fingers crossed that funding comes through. We'll know by the end of the year. And we'll ramp that up next spring. And then, like I said, hopefully have more resources to do a better job at just what you said.
Yeah, so I could see, that Benton Harbor students at the high school level, instead of working at McDonald's or wherever there, could be working on different projects associated with this. So they have a sense, again, of ownership of their community, and they are employed in these areas. I know Susan Buchanan was asking some questions even before the meeting. I have some questions along the same line, but Susan, do you want to ask your questions too?
Well, I did have some questions about the contaminants, but it sounds like you said that the state is going to come in and do some measurements of the sediments, so there'll be a better idea of what exactly is in the creek.
Yeah, we don't have a good idea of how much of that contamination from some of those neighboring properties has gotten into the creek itself. So they were just, the team from Eagle was just here 2 weeks ago, and I gave them a tour, and they've picked out 12 sampling sites between Hall Park and Napier Avenue that they're going to go in and take samples from each of those 12 sites and look at this. Great. They're going to do a grain analysis for the sediment, but they're also going to test for metals, PCBs, PAHs, PFAS, and probably some other things that I don't even know how to pronounce.
Yeah. Well, I loved your presentation. This is all so interesting. I'm looking at it from the health perspective and definitely hoping that you're going to, it will be known what's in that water before you send children in it or people to fish out of it.
That's what I've been advocating since the beginning is we need Tamara, who is on here, has done a lot of that work from Eagle and coming out and testing and collecting data. And we're just, you know, going to advance those efforts to get a little bit better picture, because you're right. We don't want to encourage people being in contact with something that's not safe. So we need to understand that. And we also have another team from Eagle that has a grant from EPA for brownfields, and they're starting the process of looking at the land, that railroad corridor. Sometimes railroad corridors can be quite polluted, whatever the trains were carrying, and they have spilled and that kind of stuff. So they're getting ready to, so the one Eagle team is going to be testing in the creek. This other Eagle team is going, and also EPA, and their technical assistants for brownfields, they're going to be testing or potentially testing on the land along this corridor so that we know it's safe to build a trail there and, you know, encourage people to use the property in that way. And then the harbor plating site, which is that big contaminated site, they're in the process of doing more testing there too to see what is it going to take to clean it up, and can it be cleaned up to a standard where it could support development like housing or not? You know, how much is that going to cost, and is that possible? So they're in the process of that too right now.
And making sure that this site is contaminant free, that the water is clean and healthy, is a primary concern of the city, because we want kids to be able to play in that creek, to fish in that creek, and be able to eat the fish without fear of it being contaminated, to boat and kayak up and down it without us having to worry if they fall in the water that there's going to be some residual after effect that's unhealthy or something. So, and I will mention this kind of related to both questions. Benton Harbor, as I mentioned, population now a little over 9,000. Of that 9,000, 44% of our population is under the age of 19. About 20% is over the age of 60. So it's a relatively small group in between that makes up the current workforce. So we do want to and have to concentrate on expanding and improving opportunities for young people to participate in everything that goes on in the city. Mm-hmm. I am also expressing to our elected officials that we are going to have to cast a wide net to identify and bring into the city working families from areas they may want to move closer to the lake and to a place like Benton Harbor to come in and rebuild that population, occupy the housing that we're going to be developing and so forth. Because ultimately the solutions to all of the issues of the schools, of the jobs, everything else, it's all going to be tied to people and expanding that population base with a good diverse mix of people, two-parent families with children that will repopulate our schools where they get revenues on the basis of headcount, and of course the city on the basis of tax base without overtaxing anybody, but just expanding the base on which it's computed.
Okay. So one of the things that I think is going to be important, and I'm pretty sure you guys know this too, is messaging and communication. You know, we have opportunities with local media, the Benton Spirit. On every Tuesday, we have a Wake Up Benton Harbor radio show. I think part of what we need to do is also to make partnerships. I saw the long list of partnerships there, but partnerships with these type of local media. I mean, I could see every month, one full page in the Benton Spirit giving us updates, because how else would the community really know what's going on, what they could get involved in, what projects are coming up? And, you know, I don't know if everybody, even in Benton Harbor, knows all of that maps that you showed and the nooks and crannies. Just simply educating basic knowledge about the creek and, you know, its extent. And my question is, what are you guys thinking of in terms of getting the message out in a consistent way to fully engage the community?
Well, the city commission has a communications committee that has been working on examining alternatives and looking to try to do more of this. We recognize that we have people in the city of Benton Harbor that have never been to Gene Clark Park, the beach right out here on Lake Michigan. But you're right, there are a lot of things that some of our public does not know. Fortunately, our radio station does help to get a lot of information out. And we're discovering that here in the city, social media is probably the most highly and often used form of communication that's taking place. So we're going to have to tap into that also. And as you said, provide information to the newspapers like the Benton Spirit, regular daily newspaper, even the Herald Palladium, and others. And I know the city is looking at also putting out a municipal house organ that kind of talk about things going on.
So that's part of the grant proposal as well?
It is. Yes. It's built into that NOAA grant as part of the capacity and public engagement piece. That once we can hire, you know, for me, this is this much of my job. You know, it's a lot. This is a lot. And but yeah. I have lots of other things. And Alex too. He's dealing with all the issues that a city is dealing with. This is one. I mean, it's a very important to the city, but there's other things going on in Benton Harbor that he has to give his attention to too. So right. Hopefully with this NOAA grant, we can hire somebody to help us with that public engagement piece and do a better job. I do know from what I can tell that the media is really interested in this. We had great yes. media coverage at the Rain Garden. WNDU came out and did a great story. Moody and the Market did. And WNDU actually, they called me up just on Wednesday Wednesday. And we're like, hey, we had a story follow through. Can I come talk to you about Ox Creek? Because they heard about this talk.
Right.
So they ran a quick story Wednesday night on this. He's like,
yeah, I saw it.
So I'm like, that was cool. So like, I feel like the media people, they like this story. So I think we need to take advantage of that. And actually, I don't think she's on now, but Juliana Knott from the Herald Palladium was on here earlier. She was covered at the rain garden story, and she said she actually wants to meet with me next week to do a bigger story on Ox Creek. So the media seems to be very interested in this, and we need to, as soon as we get some capacity, we'll build on that opportunity. But we're open, you know, I know Priscilla was on here from the Benton Spirit. If she wants to come and talk to me and do something, I'm open and willing to do it, so.
I think I am still on the call, and hello, this is Priscilla. And you started talking earlier about partnerships. And so it's beyond even the Benton Spirit. It's one thing for the media to be there. It's another thing for the community to connect with that media, where it doesn't matter if it's $2. It doesn't matter what it takes. You know, there's one thing to reach out, but it's totally different to connect. And I think that's what we should be trying to do. Even outside of media, there's diverse media. But what we have been doing already with Benton Harbor Team Solutions, which is part of that, but it's not the only thing. With Benton Harbor Team Solutions, we're talking about community engagement, education. So it's much broader. So I would like to talk to you about that as far as a partnership. The other thing is mentioned about Susan Buchanan, but before we started, I was telling you about her. So she spoke and we talked about partnerships. This is the University of Illinois Chicago Public Health. Susan Buchanan is an MD. She contacted us along the environmental chair of MEANDRS is on this call. How can we help with this project? Priscilla, what can we do? So, you know, I am so glad that we are here today. Alex, thank you. Marcy, my goodness, this was a wonderful, wonderful presentation. I learned so much that I did not know. And I know it's still a learning process, but you do have partners right here on this call and partners right here that live in your community and work in your community that can do more than just media. They can connect. They can do community engagement, et cetera. Leslie Bakel is on this call who spoke earlier. I love the people that are on this call, but there are others who are willing to be one of your partners. And I'm so pleased that you said that on the onset of your presentation about wanting partners. So we're here and we're willing to help, because what you presented to us today, it is a wonderful visionary of how we can turn what used to be even better, even though we've been having some challenges within Arts Creek. And yeah, Desmond, you did it well at the beginning. A change is coming, and we would love to be part of that change. So thank you.
Okay.
And I would add the city's feeling about this is the more the merrier. There's plenty of work to be done and plenty to go around. I think I'd be remiss if I didn't mention, though, that a part of the community outreach that's taking place. We're doing some boots on the ground type community outreach also. EPA has funded and made available to us Miss Beth Grigsby from the University of Kansas that is specifically working to help foster community outreach with this particular program. And she has been in and out throughout the community, sometimes in parallel with Paul Lippens and the master plan effort, and then otherwise separately, conducting meetings with groups like the senior citizens group that we met with. We had about 60 senior citizens there. It was their annual picnic. The plan week that went on for a whole week downtown here in Benton Harbor. And like right now, Planning Commission and the master plan study, night before last, they were at Second Baptist Church with a group of citizens and the commissioners from that ward. Last night, they were up here at the Housing Commission office right next to Boys and Girls Club with the commissioners that cover that ward and number of citizens and so forth. And we're talking about the master plan and also everything that's going on. So there is quite an effort underway, and it's never enough. We certainly want more, and we'll be working to, and we'll appreciate all the help we can get.
So Susan, could you talk about, I know you put it in the chat, but could you talk about it, because Susan Buchanan, the environmental justice comment, because this is something, this is something that our regional EPA administrator talked to us about. We should seriously consider going for an environmental justice grant as part of this to address some of the things that we've been talking. So Susan.
Yes, absolutely, I'd be happy to. I wish I had the control of the strings of the funding, but I don't. I'm just an applicant like everybody else at the University of Illinois Chicago. But, you know, there, cynical people say the death of George Floyd has not accomplished, certainly not enough, but one mm-hmm. thing, it really did bring more attention to communities mm-hmm. in need that are historically disinvested. And one of the results is that, well, especially with the new administration okay. and the recognition of that, there is funding that it seems like every week on my emails, there's another environmental justice grant that's coming, okay. not just from EPA, but from CDC. And so So I guess I'm just mentioning that I'm aware of some, and there's one due in November with Kansas, with Beth Grigsby, you know, who's working with the KSU. They suddenly have some funding that they need to disperse. And so it needs ideas. So I'm definitely, you know, I'm actually in a group, I'm in a meeting on Monday to discuss it with some other folks at UIC, University of Illinois Chicago. But I want to bring the Benton Harbor, you know, issue to the table to this meeting on Monday. Right. And if it's not the KSU money, then I totally agree. There are opportunities out there in need of ideas. Some of them purely related to health, not as necessarily ecology of, you know, physically cleaning up areas, but there's money for that too. Mm-hmm. My interest is on the human health end of it.
Yeah.
And to piggyback on what you're saying, one of the things that's unique about the time period we're in right now and the money that's being made available, they're specifically looking to try and identify and help underserved communities like Benton Harbor and with large minority populations like Benton Harbor. This city is about 89% Black. The average median income in the city is $21,700 a year, compared to $56,000 just across the river in St. Mm-hmm. Joe and in the state in general. This city lacks the financial wherewithal to pull itself up and do it all by itself. Mm-hmm. And the funding that's out here now and the involvement of good people like yourselves and trying to assist and help with this is making a major difference to change that picture. And we're moving as rapidly as we can to take advantage of the opportunities to make use of it and to do the different things that need to be done. This city just has completed approximately 95% of the replacement of its lead water surface lines, which is a major thing. Without the monies that the governor made available to help us, this would have taken probably 15 or 20 years to do. So it's a plus. So we want to do the things that are necessary, have everybody involved that wishes to get involved, and get the word out that we're open for people to come and live in a beautiful community sitting on Lake Michigan, St. Joseph River, what's going to be with Ox Creek. And we're blessed also to have in our midst Whirlpool Corporation, which is trying to assist the city in areas. This past year, they spent $500,000 upgrading Union Park for the city. I meet getting help with from them on Hall Park and other things that we have going on here. So there is a movement afoot, and we want to keep it going and want to more the merrier.
Okay, that's a good way to probably end this, because we're getting close up to 11 o'clock now. So we want to thank everyone on here. We want to thank Ms. Marcy Hamilton. Very good presentation, very inspiring, very informational. Thank you also, Mr. Little, for all
You're
of
welcome.
The experience, information, insights, and being able to give us the global picture of what we are trying to do in terms of redeveloping Benton Harbor. Thank you, Susan, for your input. Prinsella, Leslie, we want to thank you all. And hopefully most of you, if not all of you, would be on next week for wildfires. So
hi. Thank you.
Have a wonderful, wonderful day and weekend. Take care, everyone.
Thank you, Dr. Murray. Thanks, everyone, for participating. Have a great day.
Okay, thanks. Bye-bye.
For more information about our sponsors and partners, please visit the Environmental Fridays Partners and Sponsors page. Be sure to visit our website at www.theenvironmentalfridays.com.